Hey everyone, we've got another heart today. This is number 109 in our collection, and the heart was sat roughly in the chest like this, with the anterior surface coming out towards the screen, posterior surface towards the turntable, head or superior here, legs are inferior down here, left over here, and right over here. So why don't we start off as we usually do, which is by trying to identify, at least externally, what appears to be the right atrial appendage. And here we find an appendage that is broad-based, triangular, pyramidal in shape, consistent with what we would expect, at least externally, to be a right atrial appendage. So why don't we go ahead and open up the heart here. And when we do that, we see pectinate muscles that spill outside the confines of the appendage. You can see them here as well, all consistent with a morphologic right atrium. And as we open up this right atrium, we immediately see that we are dealing with a heart with an atrioventricular septal defect, and that there is a large defect, an interatrial communication in the oval fossa itself. So an oval fossa defect as well as an atrioventricular septal defect. And then here is the mouth of the coronary sinus. Now, I think this is important to highlight that here is the atrioventricular septal defect. There's intact septum here. And then here is the oval fossa atrial septal defect. So two separate atrial level shunts. One is the true interatrial communication, and the other is in fact an atrioventricular level defect. Now, generally, we identify the triangle of Koch, which is bounded by the mouth of the coronary sinus, the tendon of Todaro, and the right AV junction. That triangle would exist the apex of that triangle would be roughly here. And that's where we'd expect to find the atrioventricular node. However, you can see that there'd be very limited ability for the atrioventricular node to jump this defect. So in fact, there's a different triangle in these hearts with an atrioventricular septal defect. It's a triangle of Thien and Anderson. And we would actually, in fact, expect that the atrioventricular node would be here at the apex of that triangle and inferior displaced. So inferior displacement of the atrioventricular node, which is also what we find electrocardiographically on EKG. Now, we do know that there's an atrioventricular septal defect, so why don't we take a look at the valve itself? So now here is the common atrioventricular valve, as we expected to find. And here is the superior bridging leaflet. Here's the inferior bridging leaflet. And we can see the inferior bridging leaflet coursing over the crest of the ventricular septum with direct connections to the crest itself. So let me try to open this up a little bit. So here's the ventricular septum. Here is the crest of the septum. And you can see direct connections of the inferior bridging leaflet to that crest of the ventricular septum here. Now, when we look at the superior bridging leaflet itself, here is the right-sided component, and here is the left-sided component over here. Here's the crest of the ventricular septum here. And now when we looked at the lift up the superior bridging leaflet and expose the crest of the septum, we don't see any connections between the superior bridging leaflet and the crest of the ventricular septum. But we do find that there are connections to the septum here. And here are those connections right here between the superior bridging leaflet and the ventricular septum. So this would be a Rastelli type B. So once again, here's the superior bridging leaflet. Here's the right-sided component. Here's the left-sided component back here. Here's the crest of the ventricular septum. There are no connections of the superior bridging leaflet to the crest of the ventricular septum, so it's not a Rastelli A. And here's the ventricular septum itself. And there are connections of the right-sided component of the superior bridging leaflet to the septum, consistent with a Rastelli B, okay? Now, when we look at the ventricle itself, we see coarse trabeculations. And we do find a septomarginal trabeculation consistent with a morphologic right ventricle. And just to kind of demonstrate from here, here is the crest of the ventricular septum. And if we lift up the valve leaflets here and expose that, we find that we don't see any connections from the superior bridging leaflet to the crest of the ventricular septum. And here is, in fact, the superior bridging leaflet here, at least the right-sided component of it. Now, when we get to the right ventricular outflow tract, we do find an arterial valve that has three leaflets and three sinuses. There aren't any coronaries that appear to be arising from the sinuses, all consistent with the morphologic pulmonary valve. Note that this pulmonary valve, as we usually expect it, is completely supported by muscle. Once again, as we usually go through with all these videos, want to make the point that the arterial valves do not have a true round or oval annulus. What we refer to as an annulus clinically is truly a man-made construct, which is fine, it is helpful, it serves its purpose. But the true annulus of the arterial valves is actually crown-shaped, as the fibrous leaflets of the valve do have these triangles of myocardium interposed in between them. So unlike the atrioventricular valves, the arterial valves don't have a true round or oval annulus. Here's the pulmonary trunk here, which then gives rise to the left and right pulmonary arteries. All right. And we can also see if there is an arterial duct that's patent, and there doesn't appear to be one. Now let's go ahead and look at the posterior aspect of this heart. And we'll find the left atrial appendage here. It's actually been cut open, which is kind of nice. Why don't we go ahead and open it up? And we open up the left atrial appendage. We see that all the pectinate muscles are, in fact, confined within the appendage itself. Now, when we open up the more posterior atrium, we do find a smooth-walled atrium consistent with the morphologic left atrium. Here is that left atrial appendage. Once again, we'll open that up, and we can see that all the pectinate muscles are confined within the appendage itself. So if I let that close, we find no pectinate muscles that spill inside the atrium, so consistent with the morphologic left atrium. Once again, we see the oval fossa, atrial septal defect, and then we see the atrioventricular septal defect now from the left side. Note that I'm not calling this a primum atrial septal defect, because this truly is not an atrial septal defect. The defect is not in the atrial septum itself. That would be this defect here, the oval fossa defect. This is best called and termed an atrioventricular septal defect. So now when we look at this defect, we see the inferior bridging leaflet here coursing over the crest of the ventricular septum. There are direct connections between the inferior bridging leaflet and the crest of the ventricular septum. Here's the superior bridging leaflet now, coursing through that atrioventricular septal defect. Here's the left-sided component. Here's the right-sided component. Now, here's the crest of the ventricular septum here. When we lift up the superior bridging leaflet, once again, we can show that there are no connections directly to the crest of the ventricular septum. Now, when we look at this ventricle here, we find fine crisscross trabeculations consistent with the morphologic left ventricle. And when we expose the ventricle like this and open up the outflow tract a little bit, we can appreciate that the inlet component of the left ventricle is shorter than the outlet component of the left ventricle. This happens because generally in the normal situation, the aorta is wedged in between the tricuspid and the mitral valves. But since there aren't two separate valves in the setting of an atrioventricular septal defect, the aorta is sprung forward, as it must be anterior to the common atrioventricular junction, which means that this results in a shorter inlet distance than an outlet component of the left ventricle. This also results in the gooseneck deformity, which we appreciate by echo. You can also notice the scooped out appearance of the ventricular septum here, also due to the atrioventricular septal defect. It's a little hard to expose the left ventricular outflow tract, but here it is. We find another arterial valve here that has three leaflets, 1, 2, 3, with three distinct sinuses, and we do find a coronary artery arising from one of them here, all consistent with the morphologic aortic valve. Once again, like we pointed out with the pulmonary valve, the arterial valves don't have a true round or oval annulus. They have fibrous valvar leaflets with triangles of myocardium imposed such that the true annulus is actually crown-shaped. We do find that there is fibrous continuity between the aortic valve and the left-sided component of the atrioventricular valve here. Here's the ascending aorta as well. So here we've got a heart with an atrioventricular septal defect, and the superior bridging leaflet has connections to the right side of the ventricular septum, but not the crest of the ventricular septum, consistent with the Rastelli B, and there seems to be a predominantly atrial level shunt in this heart.